talk is presented by Spashiv. He's from Target Technology Company, USA.
Thank you. The first author of this report is Han Ni. He is the founder of Target Technology Company and also a sponsor of this research for 5 years. Am I loud enough? Okay. So, how to operate it? Could you help me? No? Which button to push? Oh, yes, that's it. Thank you. So it's general understanding that for low-energy nuclear reaction, one needs proper fuel, which provides high concentration of hydrogen isotope, ignition that provides high energy, and then condition at which this reaction can be sustainable, that is, energy escape preventing explosion and high isotope mobility to load the sample again. And our main purpose was to study the best fuel for such a reaction. And in our view, the best fuel could be any face-centered cubic metal with high concentration of vacancies and devacancies, which will form hydrogen vacancy complexes and also vacancy impurity complexes. And we studied these complexes using first principle modeling, then studied them experimentally, but studying super temperature prognostic desorption, and so that superabundant vacancy state can be achieved with very high concentration of hydrogen clusters. Finally, we estimated the optimal excitation energy and nuclear reaction rate with experimental values of screening potential. So modeling was done using quantum expressor available package, its density functional theory package. We used supercell approach, and here are the structures which we used are shown with vacancies and devacancies at the right panel. And the difference between these two structures is that for vacancy, all the preferable octahedral occupation sites are equal, while for devacancy, there are preferable so-called shared sites which have the nearest neighbors, both vacancies, and corner sites are less preferable, and they are much closer to the octahedral sites near a vacancy. Also, energy formation is shown for vacancy, devacancy, and the binding energy between them is about 30 millielectron volts for vacancy. The next slide shows defect formation energy, that is energy required to produce this defect with some amount of hydrogen on it. And this energy goes down as there is a segregation energy, and known effect is that at the highest occupation energy, this formation energy can be very slow or even negative. And this effect, in our case, we didn't get this negative formation energy for a single vacancy, but we get it for divacancy at the highest occupation number. One should mention that number of tested clusters is extremely high, so we showed here only the clusters with highest segregation energy. Then one should apply thermodynamic analysis to see how large is the concentration of clusters of these two sorts. And because of higher binding energy, devacancies can compete with single vacancies, and our desorption spectrum shows that this is the case. The next step is to find defect creation volume and then estimate average density of the segregated hydrogen in these clusters. And one here in the table, one can compare this density with the density of hydrogen in various other phases, and one can see that atomic density is huge. Of course, it's only close to the atomic density of metal, which is much higher than atomic density of other molecular states of hydrogen. And it's even more than average atomic density of hydrogen at the sun. And it's important thing because this density can be used to estimate the rate of nuclear reaction. The next slide shows charge distribution in the vacancy cluster and also charge redistribution in this cluster. That is depletion of charge on nickel sites and accumulation of electronic charge at the hydrogen sites. This redistribution picture on the left side shows it's important, both pictures actually are important to estimate screening potential. And the most important result here that screening is not usual screening. What, when one think about screening in homogeneous plasma, one think about a sphere about, and outside of this sphere, the potential exponentially decaying. But in metal, in fact, when one put in a discrete charge, there is no such a sphere. There is a distribution of valence electrons from nickel to hydrogen, and that forms, that is known as the formation of image charge near the metal surface. And one can see that the result is formation of dipoles in a metal. And these dipoles have quite different distribution of potential. And our feeling is that this can explain very huge values of screening potential, which are observed experimentally. I should also mention that in addition to usual occupation sites, which are octahedral occupation sites, we found that for the vacancy, there are so-called pair states, when the distance between segregated hydrogen is smaller than distance between octahedral sites. It's about 2 angstroms, and these pair states are present at the hydrogen occupying the whole vacancy plane, and also when the population of hydrogen is only 3 or 4 atoms in a segregated into vacancy. This small distance in a pair between hydrogen atoms also indicate that there is high screening potential. We interpreted as manifestation of supercapacitor effect. This supercapacitor effect now known for many structures which is actually used to produce supercapacitors, and it appeared to be that traditional formula for a capacitance doesn't apply when a single charge is close to a metal surface, because then dipole-dipole interaction which appears between this charge and the image charge, and it actually screens Coulomb potential, and therefore one can add much more charges than one could expect. So to summarize this part of my report, I should say that we see something like lattice confinement of hydrogen in these clusters, and local concentration of clusters of hydrogen in these clusters could be really huge. These clusters are stable, and thermodynamic analysis shows that this concentration of such clusters can be very high. And in our case, experimentally, we studied nickel and found that actually average concentration of hydrogen appeared to be far above the limit, which is supposed to be in the solution. And pair states in a debacancy suggest an anomalously high screening potential values. The next part is experimental studies of such clusters in nickel samples. We studied a large number of pure nickel and skeletal nickel powders with some additions. They were pressed into cylinders or used in the tube, and they were charged by hydrogen PCT machine at least for 24 hours, but usually for several days. Then by heating, this hydrogen was evacuated, and the again put into PCT machine, but of different sort, which provided loading with deuterium, also for a long time at 24C. And we studied binding energy and amount of hydrogen was there using Hariba machine, which also allows us to get temperature problem desorption spectra, which are shown here. These are very typical spectra, but actual spectra depends on the ramp of the temperature. There are always two or three lines, which are, for fresh samples, there are three lines. The lowest temperature line reflects the desorption from surface, and these two lines are usually attributed to single vacancy and devacancies. And this picture is very much similar to that of Fokai's book, but importantly, the area on the single vacancy, devacancy lines more or less the same. It depends on loading procedure. Sometimes devacancies are present and actually initial powder, that is for different powders, spectra also differs. But anyway, we were able to reach very high concentration of hydrogen, much above solubility limit, up to 8% of atomic hydrogen. Atomic concentration of hydrogen. And we think that these ideas about the superabundant cluster, superabundant vacancy phase could explain former results. For example, electrolytic charging of palladium requires very long time to charge it properly. And we are sure that it's just a long time which is necessary to create a high amount of this vacancy-devacancy clusters because very slow vacancy diffusion rate from the surface compared to case of Fukai, which used extremely high pressure and extremely high temperature. As the opposite side, when palladium films are deposited from a solution, at extremely high electronic current density, it always the structure is dendritic, and the vacancies are deposited together with deuterium. So no incubation period required in this case. And most probably, this hypothesis of superabundant vacancy phase can be verified or rejected using just temperature problem desorption experiment and looking at the spectra. Last part of my report, okay, is somewhat as a bridge between hot temperature nuclear science and low energy to nuclear science. That is, we used standard equations for nuclear reaction rate to estimate. That's it. the reactivity. For known nuclear reactions using standard equations and modified them in a traditional way to include exponential enhancement factor, which depends on the ratio of screening potential and average energy of the hydrogen isotopes in our clusters. And the important thing that there are dozens of extraphysical papers that study these low energy nuclear reactions at the astrophysical object, and their conclusion was that one can never achieve the gamma factor which enters into exponent more than 170. That is a magical number and can't exceed it. And, but it corresponds to enhancement factor of 10 to the 74, which is huge. So the question is, first, can we achieve such an enhancement? And what will happen if we achieve it? to achieve it, we can use experimentally found screening potential values and estimate nuclear reaction rate with this experimental values. Still, I should add that these equations were not only applied to astrophysical objects, but also tested in experiment, just in plasma experiments. And the density of laboratory plasma is much lower, but still gamma factor was that was reached in the laboratory was 25, but we need 170. So the fact is that when we go to very low temperatures, one can't use this magical number 170 because the distance which hydrogen isotopes should tunnel into the other nuclear become pretty large, and at large, this turning point from which nuclear starts to tunnel appear to be at a large distance, and at this distance, the screening potential is reduced. That is experimentally found. Screening potential is found for in kilo electron volt range of energy, and we are trying to apply it to electron volt energy. Then we should use this corrected formula, which is shown on this picture. And using this experimental values of screening potential, we calculated reactivity, that is cross section average with temporal distribution, and then estimated optimal excitation energy, which appeared to be lower for nickel than for palladium. That is energy at which enhancement factor is maximum, but the reaction rate is still much higher for palladium. And resulting rate of the nuclear reaction is pretty high, so this rate will not limit the reaction rate, but the reaction rate in a sample will be limited by the hydrogen diffusion and recharging of such samples. This slide is somewhat speculative. That is, we don't know actually the mechanism that could ignite traditional low energy reaction is this cluster. But if this mechanism of excitation is found, then one could expect, then one could just observe that it's, since it is traditional reaction, that this reaction will just produce high energy particles when be emitted from these clusters, and nothing tragic will happen with this high energy particle, then they will lose their energy through electronic losses, that is, in a sense, plasmon emission by Cherenkov emission along the tract of emitting high energy particles. So plasmon energy is 20 electron volts for nickel and 25 for palladium. One can also imagine that the surface plasmon energy is much lower, and one can imagine that if one could be able to convert these plasmons with the energy of particles in the clusters, then everything would be quite okay. That is, one can tune both, that is, energy losses by varying concentration of such clusters, and also tune the recharging of these particles by varying ambient pressure. So if plasmon could be in any way used for ignition of such clusters, then low energy nuclear reaction could even be self-sustained. So conclusion of my report is first that such complexes can provide extremely high ash loading and extremely high local concentrations. These clusters, in our view, are most probable nuclear active centers. Experimental values of screening potential suggest that optimal excitation energies could be in electron volt range, which is pretty low compared to other ways to ignite the reaction. And high screen potential values may be caused by the image charges which always emerging at the metal surface when hydrogen is put at vacancy in the inner surface. One can rephrase these conclusions in more optimistic or encouraging way that these clusters provide lightest confinement suitable. So these clusters are suitable as a fuel for nuclear reaction. And high plasma screening at the surfaces make thermonuclear burning at low energy possible. And energy dissipation is provided by plasmon emission. And limitation of, by diffusion of D to these clusters could make low energy nuclear reaction not only sustainable, but tunable. And if one can imagine ignition mechanisms, then low-energy nuclear reactions can be implemented with the standard solid state and nuclear physics theories. Thank you for your attention. Here are publications.
I can take one or two questions. Go ahead.
Hey. So you have a number of approaches to estimate the screening. However, you're neglecting your most powerful tool. If you're doing DFT calculations, you have the possibility of putting your deuterons or hydrogen atoms closer and further apart to get the energies, which would actually get you a DFT screening, which would be far better than from the other estimates.
Yes, it's correct. But we haven't done it. That is, this quantum express package is not very stable for these calculations. And the second point is that we used it for nickel, and nickel have spin structure. And so all calculations are much more difficult than for palladium. But for palladium, it can be really done.
My problem, and the problem of the field in general, is to identify how to make palladium or some other material nuclear active on command. Now, my question to you is, how can you use your theory to guide that search, to show me where to look, how to treat the palladium, so that I can acquire success on a more or less predictable way? And I would ask all theoreticians to try to answer that question, because your theory is not very useful to the rest of us unless you can show us how we can make this work more predictably.
Well, my answer as a theoretician, there are, seems to be a predictable way to create vacancies. That is, people know how to create vacancies. If vacancies are already there, then loading of these vacancies by hydrogen is a pretty simple process, because these vacancies act like a sink for diffusion of hydrogen. That is, hydrogen diffuses to them and attached to them by the segregation energy, which is huge enough compared to temperature, so they are stable. That's it. That's my answer. Okay.
Okay. So any more? So let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.
Oh,